We thank you. As we come to your word, we pray that you will speak to us, that we will become more like Jesus. We ask these things in his precious name. Thanks, Jamie. Now, as I used to look across the road at Jamie and Di, it never occurred to me that one day Jamie would be correcting the microphone. God is amazing. Amazing grace.
Yeah.
These past Wednesday afternoons I've been driving to a correctional centre, hopping in the prison van with a prisoner and an officer, and going to a university college, and sitting very closely with that prisoner, me with my computer and Bible, preparing this message, and the lads doing the downloading material, and I had to keep an eye on her computer that she was only downloading material for her course. And but it was a marvellous time for me just to sit there quietly with God's word and his Holy Spirit. And I just was really challenged to talk about something that's been very special on my heart, and I'll share with you what it is shortly. But Friedrich Buchner has said, we see God's word clearly only now and then. Of course, we see God's hand in nature. We see God's hand as we hold a newborn baby, which I did recently. But seeing him working in our lives, and it's not always easy to see. The Lord seemed to be highlighting that God doesn't allow us to see everything clearly all the time, but prefers now and then to break into our lives with amazing and sometimes unsettling surprises. Consider the following examples. How would you feel if you were Noah? I want you to build an ark, Noah, and I want to save you and your family from the world. A big ask. It had never rained before. Noah had never seen an ark, but this was God's plan for Noah. And then one day, as Moses is walking in the desert, 80 years old was he at the time, around about, he sees a bush on fire that doesn't burn up. He hears God speak to him and is commissioned to be the deliverer of God's people from Egypt. How about that? When God unexpectedly breaks into our lives, although the events may not be as dramatic as these examples, each is nevertheless very significant. I want us to look at a time when the Lord is going to break into all our lives. Are you ready? Jesus said, be ready too, for the Son of Man is coming at an hour when you don't think he will. You'll read about that in Matthew 24:44. I'm referring to the second coming of Christ. During my latter teen years, I was having music lessons with a Mrs. Shakespeare. She was a woman in her 60s. She seemed very old to me, but she could play the piano. Mrs. Shakespeare and her late husband had been missionaries in India. However, at that time, she played the piano for Keswick conventions, and she regularly played the piano for a monthly series of meetings in the city in Brisbane. The name for this particular Christian movement was the Second Coming Testimony and Preparation Fellowship. The chairman at the time was Mr. George Spall, who was an evangelist to Jewish people who lived in Queensland. And Mrs. Shakespeare would sometimes ask me to play the piano for these meetings when she wasn't able to do so. And these times exposed me to the wonderful teaching surrounding the second coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. There are some comings of the Lord that we do celebrate. Very shortly, we're celebrating the first coming of the Lord Jesus as a baby in Bethlehem, born of the Virgin Mary. And this was prophesied, and those prophecies came to pass, literally. We celebrate his first coming in a very special way. We can have confidence that the prophecies of the second advent or coming will also be fulfilled literally and not in a figurative or spiritual sense. Then there is the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ for each one of us when our lives on this earth has ended. He says in John 14:3, if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, you may be also. We can be assured he will be there to meet us when we leave this body. Jesus said to Martha, when she was mourning the passing of her brother Lazarus, he said, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me shall live, even if he dies. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this? John 11:25-26. Do you believe this? I certainly do. But the Bible teaches us there will come a time when the Lord will appear in the heavens. Now there are some prophecies about this in the scriptures. The first one I recall is from Enoch. You might remember that Enoch was the father of Methuselah. Now Methuselah lived 969 years. We're told in Genesis that Enoch walked with God and one day was not, because God took him. And he was seven generations from Adam. You know, he didn't live very, he wasn't that far from Adam. And we read about this in Genesis 5:24. And Peter takes up Enoch's prophecy about the, Jude takes up this prophecy about the Lord's second coming in Jude 15:15. And these are the words of Enoch. Behold, the Lord comes with many thousands of his holy ones to execute judgment upon all, to convict all the ungodly of their ungodly deeds, which they have done in an ungodly way, and of all the harsh things which ungodly sinners have spoken against him. These are grumblers, finding fault, following after their own lusts. They speak arrogantly, flattering people for the sake of gaining advantage. Now, Enoch spoke these words before Noah's flood. And then Daniel. You know, he spent a peaceful night in a lion's den. And this is what Daniel said. I saw in the night visions, and behold, one like the Son of Man came with the clouds of heaven. You can read that in Daniel 7:13. And Jesus foretold the event himself in Matthew 25:31. When the Son of Man shall come in his glory, and all the holy angels with him, then shall he sit upon the throne of his glory. Jesus also said, the sun will be darkened, the moon will not give its light, the stars will fall from the sky, and the powers of heaven will be shaken. And then the signs of the Son of Man will appear in the sky, and then all the tribes of the earth will mourn, and they will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of the sky with power and great glory. And he will send forth his angels with a great trumpet, and they will gather together his elect from the four winds, from one end of the sky to the other. That's in Matthew 24, verses 29 to 31. One day I was talking to my children and I was preparing them for the coming of the Lord. I said, you might be at school or you could be out with your friends and then the world becomes suddenly dark. Don't be afraid. Look up. Jesus is coming and we'll meet each other in the air. Because if it's daylight here, it will become quickly dark. It was foretold by Paul when he charged Timothy, fight the good fight of faith, take hold of the eternal life to which you were called. And he made the good confession in the presence of many witnesses. I charge you in the presence of God, who gives life to all things, and of Jesus Christ, who testified the good confession before Pontius Pilate, that you complete the commandment without stain or reproach until the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he will bring about at the proper time. That's in 1 Timothy chapter 1, verses 12 to 15. So, chapter 6, verses 12 to 15. This was also foretold by the angels. Remember, when Jesus rose from the dead, he appeared to his disciples, to others, and then he brought his disciples to a mountain. And just before he went back to heaven, in Acts chapter 1, verses 10 and 11, we read, and as they were gazing intently into the sky, while he was departing, behold, two men in white clothing stood beside them. And they also said, why do you stand looking into the sky? This Jesus, who's been taken up from you into heaven, will come in just the same way as you have watched him go into heaven. Now the time of Christ's coming, that's a bit of a mystery. This is a secret that only the Lord knows. Jesus said, but of that day and hour, no man knows, not even the angels of heaven, but my Father only. That's in Matthew 24, 36. And then in Matthew 24, 44 and 45, he says, for this reason, you be ready too, for the Son of Man is coming at an hour when you don't think he will. Who then is the faithful and sensible? Jesus Christ as man didn't know the date, but Jesus Christ as God is omniscient, that is all knowing, and certainly knows the exact moment when it will occur. So I want to talk a little bit about faith and good sense, or being sensible. As he said, who then is the faithful and the sensible? Jesus said, when speaking about the last days before he returns, in Matthew 24, 10 to 13, many will be offended. Have you found that? You've been meeting people who have been offended, who are angry and repelled by their association with me, and will fall away from the one whom they should trust, and will betray one another, handing over believers to their persecutors. They will hate one another. Then many false prophets will rise up and deceive many, but he who endures to the end shall be saved. Jesus also said, because lawlessness is increased, most people's love will grow cold, but the one who endures to the end will be saved. That's in Matthew 24, verses 12 and 13. He's talking about people who once loved. In the book of Revelation, he addressed the church of the Laodiceans and said, I know your deeds, that you're neither cold nor hot. I would that you were cold or hot. So because you are lukewarm and neither hot nor cold, I will spit you out of my mouth. That's Revelation 3, 15 and 16. Sadly, I've met people who've been offended by themselves, offended by others, and offended by God. The Greek word for offense in the New Testament is scandalon. It's the part of a trap to which the bait is attached. When a hunter goes trapping for animals, he uses his trap, he puts bait on the scandalon. Consequence of picking up that bait, animals' lives are ruined and people's lives are ruined. By picking up an offence, there's wounding, there's division, there's separation, there's broken relationships, betrayal and backsliding. I want to talk briefly about being offended with ourselves. When we offend our conscience, go against our conscience, we offend ourselves. When our daughter was 15, she ran away from home. And I knew at that time that I had failed as a godly mother. And as a result of that, I was so offended with myself that I felt I couldn't serve God anymore. In fact, that weekend I was to play the piano for a minister's wives' conference. But that very night, John read this passage of scripture as we read the scriptures and prayed together in Galatians 6:9. Let us not lose heart in doing good, for in due time we will reap if we will not grow weary. And at that time in my life, I had grown weary and extremely discouraged. But God picked me up. And sometime later, God took hold of that young woman's life. And she's now serving the Lord. A pastor's wife told me that she noticed that parents of single, pregnant daughters stopped going to church. She found that over the years because parents were so ashamed of themselves and thought of themselves as failures. But you know, the Lord doesn't want us to take that bait. He wants us to hold on to Him and trust God for our daughters and for our sons. And then there are those of us who are offended by others. And haven't you met Christians who used to go to church, they've been hurt, never go back again, they say. Corrie Ten Boom and her sister suffered much at the hands of prison guards in war camps in Germany during the Second World War. Betsy died in the camp, but before she died, she said, Corrie, we must tell people to forgive. Because if they don't, they will never get better. And so Corrie said, yes, I will travel, I will preach, I will tell people to forgive. But hey, one night she was in a hall in Europe talking about forgiveness, and at the end, a prison guard came up to her, put out his hand and said, Crawling, isn't it wonderful we can forgive each other? And she looked at him and she thought, I will never forgive him. But then she remembered and she said, Lord, I can't, but you can. So Corrie put her hand out to that man, and as she did, the love of God flooded. Just flooded her life, moved through her to him. This is what the Lord Jesus says, for if you forgive men for their transgressions, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive men, your Father will not forgive your transgressions. Those are very powerful words. Now, sadly, there are those who are offended by God. We read that many were offended by Jesus. They were so offended that they crucified him. a relative of John's and mine, who's been a Christian for a number of years, even preached in our church when John was the pastor at Boondall. He's now turned away from the Lord because he couldn't get his head around his perceived reality. That is, that the Lord healed his little boy from leukemia. But the Lord let another child in the hospital ward suffer and die. In fact, this nephew has become so angry with God that it has cost him his marriage as well as his faith. All of us have opportunities to be offended. And Jesus said in Luke 17 verse 1, it's impossible that no offence should come. We're still going to be offended. It's a tool of the devil to bring people into captivity. May we never say, oh, that's unforgivable. It should never be on our lips. The Lord wants us to give each offence to him and let him vindicate us. He says, vengeance is mine, I will repay. And one of my favourite verses is Exodus 14:14. The Lord will fight for you while you keep silent. As we recall the great love that God has shown for us, in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us, we can rely on him daily to enable us to forgive others, to forgive ourselves, and most of all, to forgive him. How foolish we would be if we turned our back on him when he comes again. How does an eagle deal with a toxic snake? It's amazing. It lifts the snake high up above the clouds, where the snake is absolutely helpless, and then it drops it. The Lord wants us to lift our offences and hurts up into the heavenlies through prayer and let him deal with them. And it's amazing what he will do. I can tell you a number of times he's done that for us. He wants us to walk in his love, depend on him daily, and you will be ready, and so will I, for when he comes. In Philippians 1:6, in the Message, this is what we read. There has never been the slightest doubt in my mind that the God who started this great work in you will keep at it and bring it to a flourishing finish to the very day Jesus Christ appears. Can I leave you with the words of this song, The King is Coming, written by Bill and Gloria Gaither. The marketplace is empty, no more traffic in the streets. All the builders' tools are silent, no more time to harvest wheat. Busy housewives cease their labours, in the courtroom no debate. Work on earth is all suspended as the King comes through the gate. Happy faces line the hallways, those whose lives have been redeemed, broken homes that he has mended, those from prison he has freed. Little children. Joan, you can read the rest of this. Little children, get your glasses on. Yeah. Hand in hand.
Little children, hand in hand, stand all aglow, who were crippled, broken, ruined, clad in garments white as snow. I can hear the shards rumble.
Chariots.
Oh, yes. I can see the marching throng, the flurry of God's trumpets spell the end of sin and wrong. Regal roads are now unfurled, heaven's grandstand all in place. Hampton's choir is now assembled. Start to sing Amazing Grace. Oh, the King is coming, the King is coming. I just heard the trumpet sound, and now his face I see. Oh, the King is coming, the King is coming. Praise God, he's coming for me. Oh.
Very good.
Thanks, John. That was really lovely.